For me to introduce Gertrude Kurbis to you tonight. It had been, I guess, about 22 or 23 years since I had seen Gertrude and since we had worked my desk behind hers in the office of Pace Associates in Chicago back in 1952 and 1953. Before I knew Gertrude, she had graduated from the University of Illinois and then had gone for a degree in architecture at the Harvard Graduate School of Design. And when I knew her, she was working part-time for Pace Associates. She was a graduate student under Mies at the Illinois Institute of Technology. Mies van der Rohe, and was doing, by the way, a very interesting thesis at that time that I got to see occasionally, and was recently married and was getting ready to have her first child, and I think he's now 22 or 23 years old and a tennis pro and getting ready to head for a tour of South America. She also has two other children. Worked for a variety of offices and with her own office in Chicago. She is on the board of directors of the Chicago chapter of the American Institute of Architects. She's on the Chicago School of Architecture Foundation. She's on the Mayor's Commission for the Preservation of Chicago's Historic Architecture. She has been a member of the AIA National Committee on Architecture for Arts and Recreation. She is on the AIA National Committee on Design. And she was a member of the AIA National Awards Jury last year. She is a fellow of the American Institute of Architects. We're very proud to have Gertrude here with us tonight to tell of a project that is almost completely of her own making, and I think she can give us the full story. It's an interesting one and one that all architects should be involved in. I think maybe Gertrude will say we shouldn't get involved in developing our own projects, but maybe she will say that it's a good thing. Gertrude Kurbis.
Architectural learning experience begins modestly enough in putting object and space together. Architects never let up until we have developed a Weltansicht, a worldview of contemporary architecture through through architecture. It's kind of a world in macrocosm. A half century ago, the great modern cultural revolution brought with it a whole ideological base. There was an abstract, preconceived architectural order in the creation of a new human environment. Standardization and mechanization provided a new technology. architects took the facts of the building, transcended these facts into, quote, the realm of the significant, unquote. Mies said, again, quotations, architecture is the will of an epoch translated into space, unquote. It was a time of giants. Who could challenge the lofty motives of expression at that time? Yet, suddenly, the giants grew older and quieter. The idea became a little redundant, and criticisms arose. Why the stain for popular culture? The technological expression became passé, and the burning torch was thrust into new hands. Venturi opened our eyes to the nature of things as they really are in the United States, in the small town, in the super city, in his almost all right Main Street USA. The incongruencies, the inconsistencies, the complexities and contradiction, the common, the confused, mass-produced mess, which has truly been our contemporary environment. He said, let it all hang out. Look at it. It's rich, vital, diverse, and it's what it is. Though I may be appalled at the unattractiveness of Venturi's architectural solution, I must applaud his exposure of our idealistic myths. His new appraisal is a healthy aspect for architecture. He refocused our reality buttons. I would hope that Venturi's method of critical appraisal could be applied to the more mundane aspects of architecture. If it would afford the same kind of rewarding insight to our new problems in the practice of architecture. Just as architectural expression offers a kaleidoscope of visual experiences in the world of architecture, the practice of architecture should offer a kaleidoscope of opportunities in the field of architecture. Please bear with me as we leave the talk, the sublime aspect of architectural form and expression, to probably the ridiculous aspect of the workaday world of architecture. The reality now is not how are we going to solve today's architectural problems, but are architects going to be given an opportunity to solve them at all? Because it seems the central underlying problem facing our profession today is your problem most of all, is the problem of earning a living in a relatively poorly paid profession. The building industry has expanded while impending disaster awaits our own allied profession. There are 25,000 students in schools of architecture. That's one student for every member of the AIA. A ratio of 1-to-1. While on the other hand, in the medical profession, there are 65,000 students in schools with about 250,000 physicians in the country. That ratio is 4-to-1. Inject this into a profession already overcrowded, hit by unemployment, exacerbated with a diminishing share of the building market, and you can foresee the disaster. As increasing numbers of architects compete for a limited amount of work, more and more will both get less work and less money for it. This trend is not irreversible. We should take charge of our profession. The vision of Venturi is now needed to find the diversity in potential opportunities for practicing architecture. Last year, the AIA held an economic charrette where our professional economic crisis was attacked. The resulting recommendations, published in April 1975, led to a variety of diversified suggestions. Yet all of these suggestions in the areas that were made were tired and worn. We used to call many of these suggestions the expanded method of providing architectural services. They were saying, now, go into the interior design field. In the old days, we would feel horrified if we had to, personally, as a woman, I was horrified to be put into an interior design department. And another suggestion was environmental improvement programs, rehabilitation, retrofitting structures to become barrier-free or energy-efficient. These are all aspects of our profession we have thought about and might do in the future, given the opportunity in the normal evolution of our profession. Some of the suggestions that might have required the learning of alternate skills, languages, managerial and sales techniques of alternate markets. In our conventional ethical mode of practice, some of these activities will lead many architects to diversify right out of the profession. Yet what a tragic loss. Architects should not have to leave the profession to make a living while continuing to serve society. Architects should be able to move into an expanding future, not a constrained future, which we are providing today in our profession. The most constraining aspect within our profession is our code of ethics. Our code of ethics consists of a lot of thou shalt nots, which have built a wall of protectionism around our profession, a restraint of trade, in which we have only restrained and isolated our own selves. The pattern of protectionism has led us to present the present intolerable reality with a continually diminishing base in which to practice. Well, we must go on the offensive. We must reform our ethical standards to compete in the broadened marketplace. We must do even more. We must make available alternative methods of practicing architecture conforming to those newly evolving ethical standards. We must even begin to train people within our schools in these new alternative methods of practice, even when we ourselves are only now searching out these new alternatives. After working for 5 years with C.F. Murphy in Chicago and another 5 years with SOM in Chicago, I left the large office practice to start on my own. With clients at a premium, no new kind of story about that, I engaged in the usual ethical professional activities. I participated in authorized architectural competitions. I taught in an architectural school. I did small scale building here and there. I even developed my own kind of personal Weltansicht philosophy of architecture, but it was much ado about nothing. 15 years ago, I initiated my first development. At that time, ethical constraints were paramount. Being a, quote, high-class architect, unquote, with a capital A, I took the ethical aspect of our profession very seriously. I told my then husband, a tennis pro, that he should play the client role and I would play the architect's role. And the script storyline was, we proceeded to develop one of the first indoor tennis clubs in the Midwest. The story ending, my husband, he was delighted. From tennis bum, he became the owner of what turned out to be a bonanza business. Me, I had maintained my professional ethics. However, I didn't even get a fee on that one. But I learned some wise lessons about life, and especially about the ethical practice of architecture. Our ethical posture has certainly moved around a good deal in the more recent years, which may illustrate our basic insecurity. The 1967 revised edition of our standards of ethical practice defined this, our obligation to the public. Quote, an architect shall not engage in building contracting to the client, unquote. The 1975 revised edition now states, quote, "An architect may not engage in building contracting where compensation, direct or indirect, is derived from profit on labor materials first in the building procedure, in the building process." So much for that. Can't even work for a builder. All right, here's another one. The original 1967 revised edition of our Standards of Ethical Practice defined this obligation to the public. Quote, "An architect shall not have financial or personal interest which might tend to compromise his obligation to his client. An architect shall not accept any compensation for his professional services from anyone other than his client." When the big remodeled version published in 1975 then had this to say, quote, "They now recognize that maybe architects could be owners. They say, as participating owner of the project, an architect may perform any role legally consistent with the position of ownership." Well, that's pretty good. But then it goes on to say, "A real or apparent conflict of interest must be resolved in the best interest of the client." Well, that doesn't even make sense. Who's the client? The architect was at least a partnership client, supposedly. So who is the client in that? We don't even know what's going on. Or the people who write the ethical standards do not. It was an improvement, but it just improves one opinion that our distinguished colleagues simply are totally unfamiliar with this whole game of development and building. We are making modifications on an outmoded shield of honor when there is a war going on. I would suggest we go back to finding a new definition of architectural practice. In my humble opinion, I truly believe the fundamental ethical practice of architecture is to provide those services to the public. We are still in the service of society. If I have to build a teepee with my own two hands, as my Red Sisters did 200 years ago, I will do that, and I'll take pride that the architectural solution was a sublime expression. My Red Sister architects really could put it together. In my more recent experiences, I find I should know more in still many more ways than the ethical standards of the AIA allow me to know even now. But what small amount of knowledge I have learned in these last 5 years might help and encourage others to do more and better architecture using the same anti-ethical methods. Anyway, we can help to write a new book for Washington. I want to apologize for the lack of really good visual material in talking about this project. But anyway, I will just jump into it. I would like to, now, none of these things that I'm going to talk about on this project are really very creative. Everyone can do them. Most architects do many parts of these, of putting projects together. And it's a way of putting all the parts together that's kind of interesting. And that's why I'm here. When you start a project, the first thing you have to do is, or when you are looking for a project, now you have no work at all, and you know that you can perform services to people, and you are now scrounging about, and in your living experience, within your own very own community, you know that there are things that should be done, that there are things that can be done. You notice buildings that maybe should be remodeled. You may notice that they may be located and very, very, very well located from an economic point of view. That stores seem to look good to you. Right now, everyone is noticing old buildings because it's too expensive to build new ones, and so rehabilitation is becoming very important. Well, it seems to me you have to identify the need of the community. And this leads to several problems. You have to serve, in one case, when I was developing the tennis club, we started out thinking that maybe, first of all, speaking of the function again, I came upon some indoor tennis clubs being published in tennis magazines in the East. I thought that just would be a great project to do. I was interested in open spaces, and that's my kind of space, an interior tennis club, indoor tennis club. All right, I had the function. I had the building project. There wasn't any around like it. And I now was looking around for a community. Sometimes you start with a community and you look around for what to put in it, you know, a store type of something like that. All right, but in the case of in the case of the tennis club, it was sort of reversed. I had a function, I had to look for a community. We started thinking about a community we lived in, which is it's a very natural thing, the corners that you pass, the experiences that you go through. All right. We found in this experience that perhaps this community could not support. Therefore, now the economics are now introduced into the project, this kind of facility. And so we had to continually look for where we could locate this type of function. And so it moved on into the suburb, and it moved on into a high-income suburb. Okay, now in the case of this particular project, the greenhouse, there we started knowing that it would be a residential area, and knowing that it would be knowing the function, and now we had to work with the community groups to be sure that it was acceptable to the community groups. So then you have to identify who the community groups are in order to get them kind of behind you and enthusiastic for your project. When you're starting out with a project and you don't have money, all you have to do, all you have is enthusiasm, and that's all you have to sell. And that's a very lonely kind of road. And so you have to do an awful lot of selling in the beginning of a project. Another thing that one has to do in the very beginning of a project when you're searching it is researching alternate methods. In the case of my tennis club, of course, I could go to the East Coast and I could survey what was going on there. It was a new building type, and it was easy to do, and it was a new building type in the Midwest, but it was easy to do some research of an existing type in another location. In the case of of residence, or in the case of any other particular functional need, you go to what is available in the community, what people do already accept, what they expect. You have to build on the expectations of the people within the community, because that's where it all begins. And in the case of conventional practice, of course, you usually have a client coming to you with all these preconceived ideas. In building your own and defining your own problem, you have to now rely on yourself to find and define the community needs. One of the problems of, I think, young architects especially, is that we can dream a lot, and we dream a lot in relation to projects that we have done in school, and usually they are very large-scale projects, because that's what where the groovy problems are, and they're much more interesting. Well, I found that true to be in my experience anyway. I just love big projects. I still haven't built a house. But anyway, so that's a danger, because usually you're beginning a project, you never have the economic wherewithal. So you have to now scale the project to what your capabilities are, what you think you might, in addition to the community needs, what you might bring to the project and what you have to offer. All right.
More family type housing in the neighborhood.
high-rises for a family living. So I felt that there, even though it was a high-rise site, I would downgrade it. And I took a terrible risk by doing that, because there's less density. It means that you have to amortize the price of the land over fewer number of units, and therefore your unit price, your land cost per unit goes up, and it's a possibility of being an economic disaster if it goes up inordinately. All right. Another problem about the site is you eventually will have to somehow get a project is not viable unless you have something to build on or in. So therefore, you must make arrangements, form alliances, become related to people who own the site, or somehow you must tie down the land or the building or your selected where you're going to develop the project. This sometimes you've got an idea and you're looking around for a site and you approach all kinds of people. If you were to provide services, I suggested to do a low rise and one of the problems in Chicago is you don't get nothing until you've got clout, right? But I had paid my dues in terms of not having clout. I had submitted other projects in the community, and I had gotten many architectural, much architectural recognition saying, well, the project was very, very good, but somehow she didn't get it. So evidently this was small enough, therefore, and somehow, even though somehow I was able to get an option on this site through this competition. All right, the competition in the city has many, many aspects of it. I, being a community resident, I was able to participate in some of the planning ideas with the community groups. So therefore, when this project came up before the community groups, I had some support among them. I had some support among the city. I had some. This project also has to be reevaluated from a real estate point of view, from an economic point of view, and so on down the line. And maybe about six evaluating teams did evaluate parts of the competition. But because you continually are determined to finally get a project, you sort of build up good feelings toward you, and then finally, sometimes you may be lucky. The particular submittal had to that was required by the city in this particular case had some drawings and an outline specification and a budget estimate. Now, this part of every project is in the preliminary stages is pretty common with ownership or whether you're providing these services for a promoter. All right, these are just simple-minded little drawings. The concept here that is given is that this is a community, a low-rise building. There is almost no views. It's in a rather an attractive site. It's well located in terms of the community, but not very good to look out of. The greenhouse is now isolated. All the units from the surrounding situation. They're two-story units, bedrooms on the second floor looking down into the greenhouse, and the dining room and the living room opening out into the greenhouse. This isolates even the urban traffic. traffic noise. It provides an environment to look into and to protect you from. Oh, this is a little site commission. This is a preliminary submittal to the city. So great. It's a beginning of an idea. This one is kind of a modular arrangement that you probably are all familiar with. I guess it was a 12-foot module, I can't remember. But the key thing is it formed the corners, the greenhouse corners formed an L-shaped unit. This is very, very modular, and frankly, it didn't work. This is a preliminary drawing. There's some straight stairways here, and there's much redundant circulation space, especially on the second floor where you have to return the corridor. The corridor returns were very, very long. But it's a four-story building. There's a little elevator and so on. All the ingredients of the project are right in the preliminary scheme. Now this is the pioneers of the sky dreaming. Here's 11 units and a high-rise site, and I was competing against others. Incidentally, well, I will say this: another thing that developers have is a lot of people are very greedy, and so they will bid very low on land. When you're thinking about serving society, you're thinking about simply doing nice work. You don't have to be quite as greedy, and therefore, when you enter the marketplace, you have an edge on developers, as a matter of fact, because you don't have to make that much money that fast, and therefore, you may be able to spend a little more money, you maybe give better quality, and sometimes this is a great advantage. I don't know. I'll get to that. All right, these are four floors. This is the beginning where it shows the section. Illustrating the two-story space. All right, this is the visuals of the proposal. Isn't that much interesting, but it's a pretty comprehensive analysis. And many of the things that are on this list, although this is formulated in a method that is required by the City of Chicago, or most urban renewal government finance projects, there is always a digest specification. And this is what you learn to do in school, and it'll stay with you. You always should go through these standard procedures. This is a bid offering. No, this is not important. The digest specifications is very important. Most of these items, although they're just one-line items, they stay with you throughout, and in the end, they're finally an ingredient of your final specification. It's starting to set the quality of the building, that there's quarry tile here and there and so on. And some of the stuff is really kind of silly because maybe you never get it. One of the other things that is really important, and I don't know if you do that here, but if you know what you are trying to achieve, the design objectives, it really establishes, your philosophy of design, but it really kind of clarifies to the community what you're trying to attain. And these are very, very important. It's very important on every level of building. Some of the objects in the, there are old buildings around it. I stepped back the front surface of the building in order to relate better to the adjoining and so on. The next thing, of course, is the budget. It's very important. And this, it's incredible. This is almost absolutely fictitious, especially in the last 5 years, because every year we've had increased costs. I mean, I can't believe that. Let's see. Interior finishes, $350. Some of these things are... Well, everything is completely outdated and outmoded, but at least at that time, it is an attempt to get a handle on where you are, and this is what you bring in your building package, in your promotion package, and this is very, very critical. All right, another thing is you have to get some kind of letters of recommendation. This particular man, I had done a lot of favors for. I had given him some free services on past jobs, and so now he was able to write a silly letter, but a meaningless letter that maybe the project could go ahead. And he says the project cost based, $30 a square foot. Well, here, that was in 72. This is 4 years later, and it'll probably be $60 a square foot. So these letters are really meaningless, but at the time they're written, and at the critical times, they happen to be very important. Next phase is that now you have this dream. You've clarified the dream in terms of some preliminary drawings. You've clarified it still further in terms of specifications, the writing material, the backup credentials. And now the most important thing of all is you must do an economic feasibility. All right. There are two kinds of economic feasibilities. Lots of times, but there are two kinds that are critical to you for you to understand. There's the development aspect, the development feasibility, which is if you just want to build a building and sell it. And then there's the other thing, the operational feasibility. In the tennis club, we just couldn't build a building and say, okay, this building is going to work, it's going to be economical, blah, blah, blah. It's going to do a job for the client. We then must, since it was had never been done before, it must go into very nitty-gritty research and clarification of, if this building is built, how will it operate? What kind of return on the investment? So this is an operational feasibility. And in the case of the condominium, we did not need an operational feasibility because we were building a building to sell. And therefore, our feasibility was based on just the development. The feasibility is an analysis of the project cost, what you pay for the project, and then an analysis of what you sell the project for. All right, what you face, unfortunately, I don't have this feasibility thing photographed. And I didn't even think about it because I've done so many feasibilities on this one building in the last 4 years and everyone changes. I mean, a year goes by, construction costs have doubled, and you do a new feasibility because now you can't afford to say the building costs that when it costs something else, and therefore you cannot sell it for what you said a year ago or something like that. A feasibility study in terms of what it costs are made up of direct costs, and the direct costs are what the building construction, the site costs, all the hard costs that you see in front of you when you go to a project, things that we're interested in as architects and architect students. All right, then there are the indirect costs, such as all the fees, the architectural engineering fee, the legal fee, accounting fee, the insurance, taxes, the cost of the building permit, and so on. But the really surprising aspect of a feasibility is the amount of money that is called the developer's overhead. And this overhead has to do with how the bank owes you. It is what you pay the bank to build the project. And of course there's some profit and the land cost. You lay all these out in a very organized fashion and you present it to your bank. You present it to your bank then also with the price, the sales price of your project. And usually they ought to come out. Now, unfortunately, the bank has a great deal of experience in as saying, A, the price that you sell things for, because they will enter and research and find out what the competing prices are in the community. If you attempt to sell it for much more money, obviously they know that the project isn't feasible and they know what these things cost. The value of these things. Now, the other aspect is the cost of the building. They also have a handle on that. And so there's very little that you can really manipulate, and a feasibility study will really separate the men from the boys in terms of asking for the financial help. All right, now you've done the feasibility, you've done research, you've gone to other projects, you know what's in the community, and now you have this package. It's all drawn up, it's all presented in a very professional fashion, and you are now out to peddle the project. Who you sell it to? There are so many kinds of financial packages and methods of putting them together. It is really, and as a beginner, you will attempt to peddle it in all kinds of ways. You will take it to people who own land. You will take it to people who have money. And so each of these categories are very extensive. In this case, in the case of the greenhouse, I had, so to speak, an option on this land. It was a great opportunity, and I knew if I would blow this one, I wouldn't get an opportunity like it. And the reason was that with an option on this piece of land, with no money, only a set of drawings, with an option on this piece of land, I still didn't have to have any money until I could put the whole project together. It was like a lease on life, a lease on a hope and a possibility. I could now have all the time I wanted, not paying any taxes, which was a really cool deal, and go ahead and try to peddle it to people with money, to people with the mortgaging. I could spend all the time I wanted studying the project. I could spend more time on feasibility, and so on. The opportunity is there, and I just had to have that. I just had to take the next step. Well, I got lucky. I got the option. All right, and now I started to peddle it. So I started in Chicago. There's a street called LaSalle Street, and most of our mortgage bankers are on the street. And you start at one end of the street, you go down to talk to mortgage bankers, and then you go on and you talk to insurance companies, and so on, and you name it. You know, you talk to anyone who knows anyone who might have a connection anywhere, and so on it goes. You know, you have to do your homework in order to get to this state. All right, this goes right into the financing. You now become at this point, you become a client. You are no longer an architect. You are just a developer, just like anyone else. At the time we developed our tennis club, my husband had a suit. It was his LaSalle Street suit. And this suit wore out because, because he would always wear this suit. This is his Brooks Brothers suit, as straight as possible. And this was his going to meeting suit, but it was a different kind of meeting. It was now to talk to the sharks on LaSalle Street, not Wall Street. That's big time. But anyway, and you walk in, you know, of course you have a connection somehow, somebody's brother knows somebody, and so on, in you go, and you lay this out. It was very interesting in the tennis club project because these money people would say, they're all enthusiastic for tennis, and they would say, great, you're going to build an indoor tennis club. It's going to be in Highland Park. How terrific. Listen, give me, let me reserve Sunday mornings from 9 to 11, will you? And then they showed us the door. So they knew there was a need. I mean, it wasn't even clear to them what they were doing. They were validating our project, And yet we were rejected because it simply wasn't a, as far as they were concerned, a viable project because none had been done before. And it seems that the breaks getting a mortgage or getting a commitment for the mortgage always come out of funny little, strange little opportunities that just sort of open up. You've been working for a year getting financing, and all of a sudden, around the back door, something would come up. Our tennis club, a suburban bank. My husband just ran in tennis clothes, plopped the stuff down on the table, said, "This is it. It's in the next community. You've got to do it." And the guy said, "Gee, that's pretty good, pretty interesting." But we've been running around for a year before that. In this particular project, it was another crazy thing. All the material was there. I was busy peddling it around everywhere. By this time, I was now hitting the suburban banks, and I had also tried Stone and Clement Stone and just any weird kind of connection. I'd read the real estate news, and that man had money. Wow, I'd be out calling him up the next day. But anyway, the break of this came when a young lady came into the office and asked if there was any possible way that she could get my account in the bank down the next street. And a bank I usually walked around in the Wrigley building and so on. So, and then I got to talk to the real estate, the vice president of real estate, and it's just flukes. Frankly, it has nothing to do with you. Sometimes I don't think it has anything to do with the project. It has something to do with perhaps they have a little money, and you just happen to press the right button or look the right way, or somehow they're going to open up to you. All right, I did get a commitment on this from a bank. And a commitment now is a commitment for interim financing. Interim financing is the amount of money that is only spent on the project while it is built. This is not a long-term mortgage. You have to now get a long-term mortgage, either from the same bank or from the same resource or from an alternate resource. And you have to start the whole procedure over again. A commitment is simply a letter that says, okay, we'll provide you building funds or funds for this building during a certain amount of time. It will be at a certain amount of interest, and there's a lot of other loopholes. This was no particular deal, frankly. The banker got 2 3/4 over prime, and prime, as you know, went up to 12%. So I was paying 15, close to 50, I think maybe I might have for a few days paid 15% on the project, which means that it was very costly. Now prime is down, and so I'm probably paying less than 10. But that means that the clock is ticking when you're building a building, and you're paying out every time it ticks. You pay interest that is very, very high. And so, well, I'll get to that in a little bit. It's a very pressured kind of experience. But I did have an advantage because my clock didn't tick then. I still had just the commitment on paper, and I didn't have the rest of the thing. Frankly, I did have, instead of working drawings at this time, and I had done the specifications, and I think I had bids, I believe. All right, let's go back about the professional services. You all know what kind of services, what you're learning. I mean, these kind of standard services, the architectural drawings, the engineering drawings. All right, but you also have to get a lawyer. I sometimes think lawyers are interjected into a project much too early. We really don't need them. We only need them finally, very late in the, one should be very reluctant. First of all, they're very costly. I didn't even negotiate my contract with the city because I was trying to save money. So I said, well, listen, this is a standard contract. There have been innumerable other projects built based on this contract, so therefore other people's legal fees were good enough for me. I'll have faith that this contract is okay, so I signed it. let me talk a little bit about this particular building. Okay, it is a masonry wall building. It has wood. It's we cannot use wood construction in Chicago. We have to have masonry. So it's a bearing wall. There are some minor partitions that are all sub-partitions that are also bearing. The advantage this scheme has over the other one is, which is very interesting from a planning viewpoint, and it was miserable, and I regret it to this day from a building viewpoint, is it is a split level scheme. You enter in on the middle level and you go up and you go down. This is a terrific advantage if you want to save, circulation space on the second floor. There is no return of circulation. The stairs are very, very compact. But because it's a split level scheme, all the units have four levels, the entry level, the living room, the bedroom, and a secondary level. It is really very difficult to build because the builders are doing everything on half levels, and it's hard to get around. It's a very little building. It really is, but anyway, it's an interesting experience. There's quarry tile in a lot of places. There's a lot of, the elevator has a greenhouse skylight and so on. The city of Chicago is very difficult to build in, so no matter what you do, like more recently I wasn't given an occupancy permit, and we had to battle that. There's also a battle on zoning. There's a one parking to every unit and an extra a delivery parking space. They doubted that a car could get into the interior of parking zone, the interior parking spaces, since this was a very tight lot. But anyway, all these aspects, you know, you just keep going through and you keep changing hats. You have your architect hat, you have your peddling hat, your developer hat, you have your builder hat, and it just keeps going on. One of the most difficult aspects, of course, is going out for bids and having bids come back and they're 20-25% over the budget. And you have projected all these neat kind of estimates, and all of a sudden you find out that insulated glass is 2 or 3 times what you expected, that, and now you're trying to rationalize and compete with other builders. When you have sliding doors and also outside windows, and you have a lot of high quality finishes. If one is persistent and clever, you can finally find all kinds of ways of beating the system. There's one saving in being an architect and a developer, and that is you only pay one insurance. Isn't that great? That's the only kind of financial saving that I think that I was able to find. You don't have to pay an architect's insurance as well as a building insurance, because your developer is not going to sue you since you're one of the same. The builder, I didn't build it. I had a builder build it, and I found another experience that I went through. After bidding it, of course, it was so high, we had to cut it down. There was no builder that would build this for my budget. They all said, well, we'll take off the greenhouses, give you a little patio, and you're in. Well, that's not really, I wasn't in, so I wasn't going to build it with that idea. So I continued to beat the bushes. A developer builder said that he would build it for that price. I found out he was a broker, and I signed a contract with him. I found out he was a broker. He turned into a broker. A broker is a person who just puts deals together and sends them on to other builders. And I found out that the builder that I signed with suddenly wasn't my builder. I had another builder, and so on and on it goes. This is a very, very difficult project, a difficult way to make a living. That's the way that you use, of course, I think the trick of starting out any kind of a project is you try to use the least amount of support professionals as possible in the beginning. I hope the next time around I will be able to use more. All right, now you do your own brochures. You do your own advertising. So therefore, I hope you take English and I hope you take it seriously so that you can write your own advertising material. You can design your own brochures. You can design your own logo. You should be able to design your own stationery. You should be able to do a decent graphic job on your own sign. And the more you can do, and I really mean this, the more carefully you can read a contract so that you don't have to go running to a lawyer. And I have made mistakes. This lawyer for this project said, if you don't get a typist to type some of these contracts for truth, we're going to really have to do something for you. Because I found I made typographical errors doing my own thing. I made these typographical errors and they were really crawling up the wall. But seriously, you are the broader the basis of your background, the better you will be prepared. And I would urge all of you to take all of your support educational material resources very seriously. Okay, back. Essentially, we are in the service of our projects. I don't know what's going on. I think this is about it. Oh, well, there's four floors. Two on two. And the secondary level has an exit, which kind of is a found space. And it's kind of nice. If that's upside down, backwards, or something, it doesn't matter. Okay. This is the portion of the spaces. Some of the spaces have two greenhouses. The one is kind of a storage greenhouse, which they share with an adjoining owner. And that also, I hope, will interject some social aspects into their living experience. I don't know. This is a two-bedroom unit. These are little pictures for the brochure. They're not very informative. This is the way the greenhouse will look from the inside of the space. And this is up in the bedroom looking into the greenhouse. Hopefully they'll have more green than that. All right, you go through the same routines. You have of developing, you have little models. They're just exactly like you do in school. All right, now the next problem is that you've now gone through the whole project. You now have to be sure that the public, the so-called society that you've come to school. Tell me about it. The way I dress. It's sophisticated as your office. Well, since I had that office, which was a very high rent office, I'm now in the bowels of the, it says fire escape on the door instead of my name. And also, I haven't bought any clothes in the last 2 years. But anyway, always they put this in a file now, and every other writer talks about how well I'm dressed, and I can't figure it out. It's really, but anyway, don't put it down. You have to, that is part of the game. I mean, I'm not putting it down anyway. I'm grateful. Anything they say, just spell my name right. Okay, this is the kind of thing that kind of, you know, you start with an idea and you end up with it. All right, this is this little project. There is a very rewarding aspect to this building. And that is, after you get the word out, and people do come to look at the building now, they haven't come to buy yet, but they're still coming to look. Anyway, we've made a brochure. This is some little sketches of the brochure, written the brochure, typed the brochure, and I didn't print it, but anyway, you got the idea. There is a feedback from the public, and you feel rewarded that there is some kind of of love. You're touching someone that some people feel that that this does extend to their own experience, that it would be a nice place to live. I should say that one of the problems of that interim financing that I did get, it wasn't enough money, it never is. And so you have to still have, you have to still find additional money, usually most projects do. And this money comes in the way of adding partners to your project. I also have a partner, and obviously I have to also not only solve the community's little problem that I would like to solve, my partner's pocketbook problem. And so therefore I have to be sure of making some kind of profit, and I have to be sure of somehow surviving this one and probably, hopefully going on to the next. And so that is also very critical. We have a number of people now in the course of some 4 years that we've worked with. Now the builder is really not so bad, and the lawyer really isn't so bad, but maybe the next time around we will have had the experience of working together, and it might be more efficient, and we might be able to build a bigger project. And so this is called growth, and we might do something similar to this in the suburbs. We might do an entirely different project, but it is part of the game, and it's a very exciting one. Now, are there any questions? The site is only 10,000 square feet. It is about 80 feet by 125 feet. It's a very tiny site. And the building is only, including a little basement and everything on it, is the building itself is only 20,000 square feet. Actually, it's about complete with completed with construction. It's been in construction for more than a year. It should have been done in about 10 months. I'm trying to say that the builder is not so bad, but he's costing me about $25,000 extra because of his delay. But anyway, we can attribute it to this, to this sub and that sub, and we can put it together that way. I don't have pictures because it's hard right now to take pictures of a building that's with no trees and no, just looks sort of dead. Oh yes, the apartments are quite high. The two bedroom range is 65 and 68,000. The three bedroom ranges from 82 to 96,000. So in terms of a smaller community, it would be a very high price. I will say this, that all the quality of the materials, you don't know too much about them, but anyway, all the quality of the materials are very, very high. I mean, there's quarry tile. The brick is about 15 cents a piece. It's quite, 150,000. So it's a very good, the best top-of-the-line General Electric appliances and so on. I do feel that insulated glass, which is very costly for all the glass that we have, and I do feel that the people are getting a very good buy. I don't know if they know what a good buy it is, because we have got what is specified. You know, everything is in the building the way we wanted it. So many builders, slough off, and you don't sometimes get what is specified. It's also another thing that makes it costly is the site cost, because it's a low building, and the site is costly. The site was it was $50,000. It is a which is a buy in one sense. The project is less, the total value of the project is less than $1 million. It's about $900,000. No, this is one of the problems. Now you ask me the success. I talked about going on into the future, and I haven't sold any units. I sold one unit. I sold two, but one of the young people backed, one of the young couples backed out because they couldn't get financing. What has happened now is a couple of months, you sell something I learned, and you should work back in a project when you, it's amazing that completion dates, how important completion dates are. In a residential development, one should be complete with the project in the fall or in the spring. We are now being complete with the project, now in the next couple of months. All right, which meant that we had ramps, all these levels, all over the place. We would have to go ramp people. They have a sliding, piece of 2x10. And people would have to walk into spaces that were, a drop of 35 to 32 or something like that. During October, which is when people are interested in. Now, the next time is in May. We have droves of people walking through the project now. But it's not a buying season. And it's extremely, it's extremely economically depressed in Chicago right at this time, across the city. So, but I'm very optimistic. It's just that it's a new product. Pre-selling. You pre-sell when you have certain markets. That a market that's proof. You pre-sell when you have a model. On a project this size, you don't have a model. This is a model as a residential example that they can go through. There's a whole set of more sophisticated techniques that you can do, have in larger projects. That you can, I don't even have one unit that's finished. I don't have, people can see, but they're not quite sure. It's something new. The hardwood floors. We don't have hardwood floors in the city. Most of our projects are probably here. So many of our projects are just bare concrete. You come in and roll down a rug and wrap it up. So some of these finishes, we just recently got a hardwood floor that was finished that people could really see the quality of. And that's very hard when people cannot see the product. Thank you. I'm just because I want to learn, and I do have an arrangement. Someone else will if they sell them, and if they do something that we haven't arranged with Bellamy. But I'm over there, you know. My name is on, my phone number is on, is in the ads. My phone number is on the site, and people call me, and then and I'm usually taking people around. Well, first of all, you don't know, but I've been in a large office, and I know that by once you finish drawings in a large office or one of your aspects of segmented practice, once you finish that part of the practice, you never find out. I remember I did the Air Force Academy dining hall, and for 2 years I worked on certain assumptions of the structural modification, I mean, how that roof was going to move. And I found out later that no one, after the building was up 3 years later, no one knew whether that building was really moving the way it was. So there is no feedback. Once an architect does a building, rarely does he know what the heck has happened, unless, you know, the client is suing him or something like that. Then you hear about it, really. But I want to know what those people are saying about my project. So I think it's worth my time to take those people through my building. So, in a sense, I'm learning a little bit about real estate, which I don't really want to know, but I'm more interested in what they're telling me about what the product is. Because they're my clients. Those people that are going to live in that building, I hope for the next 100 years, are going to be my clients, you know. I mean, they are my clients. They are buying this product, yes. Marketing studies are, I didn't do a marketing study, per se. But what happens in Chicago is, if there is a market, you con a market. You say, all right, he's doing something. You present your research as a marketing study. Now, a sophisticated architectural office, you know, will hire marketing experts, and they will go in and try to find out what the, they will call different real estate people and so on to find out these things. I have found so many of these experts really don't know. A product is this. Anytime you have something that deviates from the norm and they don't know and you don't know what the thing is, just like marketing studies on television. God, some of those programs, if those are marketing study results, I would rather not join the market. So this same way, with a product that's a little different, I'm talking like a developer, but with something a little bit different, how can people tell you whether you like it or not? You know, it's... That's right, a fancy signature down at the bottom of a big... Yes, that's an interesting aspect. Okay, I have no money. I have built in, well, architectural fees and so on, all in my feasibility study. Those are all. However, I had to get what they call front money, which I had to get a partner, and therefore. All right, you have this feasibility study, you give it to the bank. You have another feasibility study or something. You have another arrangement with a partner. Let's put it this way. You package different items of your project for different viewers. You package something when you want to get the land. You package another thing when you want to get mortgaging. You package another thing when you want to get a partner. Okay, now a feasibility study to my partner, you know, what did he know? As a matter of fact, he's just a very, very, very wealthy architect who never really practiced. I went to school we went to Harvard together 25 years ago. Frankly, I never even thought of asking. I've known him for 30 years, I guess, and I never even thought of asking him for money. Can you imagine knowing a man for 30 years and not even remembering that you could lean on him. But anyway, he was in the project. I was asking him for a donation to our foundation, the Chicago School of Art, the Blitzer House Foundation. And then I sort of was bemoaning the fact I couldn't put this deal together. Isn't it terrible? And he said, "Well, what do you mean?" Well, I said, "Mr. Miller, this man downstairs, another millionaire, just turned me down, and isn't it terrible?" And he said, "Well, you look what? Tell me what you need." So I saw the skies light up, and I saw that he was a poet. He'd asked me what I needed, so that meant, you know, the next step was that he might be able to provide it. And anyway, because he has a huge income, his particular problem was taxation. And so what I packaged to him was what is called a tax shelter. And so that means that he would benefit in things that I would never benefit in. And that is that he could take off his income tax, all the interest that was paid in our interim financing, take it off his income tax. And so I gave him something, since I had my income tax is minimal. I was giving him nothing that was important to me. So to him I would have to package another product, and we negotiated. And he was such a neat guy. He said, that we would be he would accept the proposal. I said, "Oh no, you have to get a lawyer." And I said, "I just got this lawyer referred to me by the bank. You should get a lawyer too." And I insisted that he would get a lawyer so that we could make this deal. And all right, they met in my office, and here he brings the best real estate man in Chicago, right? The best real estate lawyer. This man, you know, wanted to cut me in pieces. He wanted my left lung. I mean, it was just, I couldn't believe it, that, I had to do all the work, and then they take everything. No, all right, in the end, that's how, I mean, it's incredible. You really get yourself into something. But the arrangement now is that he did provide the front money. We were able to buy the land, which was one of the critical criteria established by the bank. So, one comes after another. You tie down the land, you get some sort of a commitment, you get more, but you don't get the money because you need more money. So you get that committed, and you come back, and so on it goes. And now, I'm still, still in the middle. And you're always in the middle. And while we're waiting for some buyers to take up these, take stuff off my hands. But our arrangement, of course, is going to be 50-50, which means my fee, my marketing, whatever I have been doing these last 2 years, will be in the profit. I presume that it will be more, hopefully, than the architectural fee. Now, if worse comes to worse, I will have to give parts of it away. With more real estate, I don't know what else they could do besides sell it. I mean, I could give higher fees to the real estate agent, maybe to expand the exposure or something, but I don't know if that's so important. To move the product, I guess I could lower the sales price. And that would decrease the profit. Oh, it's really interesting. You've got to do it.